Oh, guys, good, you're here. I am so excited. Guess what? I hope this isn't about your podcast again. Why? Did you finally listen to it?
Before we start this podcast, let me invite you to subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, YouTube, or any podcaster. I'm such a goober.
Hello, Pups and Kittens, and welcome to the Groomer Next Door, episode 133. This week's topic is top breeds, pros and cons. I'm your co-host, Chris Green. Sitting next to me, as always, is the fabulous Sarah.
Hello.
And, of course, coming out of her control booth is Claire.
Hello.
How are you, Claire?
Good.
Yeah?
You having a good summer?
Yep.
What's going on?
Oh, so we're off at summer break.
Summer school's over.
Yeah.
And?
And the 4th of July is almost coming up.
Right.
It's only on Monday.
Uh-huh.
And you get to shoot out the fireworks.
Did you know there's some places that aren't allowed to shoot off fireworks?
Oh, yeah.
Yep, where we used to live, they can't do fireworks there.
Yeah, but now they can.
Where you are at now, you can, yes. And, of course, you got to go to the carnival last night, which was fun, yeah?
Yeah, they had this cool... This time they changed the kites.
No, it's the same ride. It was the cliffhanger was still the same.
It goes in a circle, not by the folks.
Same way as it was last year.
It wasn't like a touring, like
spinning. It was the exact same thing.
Exact ride. Yep, it was. Well, thank you for sharing that with us. All right. Well, you know, before we kick off, as we had mentioned last week, Rescue One, our rescue vehicle, had been. Allegedly tampered with. After further pretty much investigation into this, it is looking pretty much about 95% that it was tampered with. Unfortunately, we have AAA as our insurance, and I'm going on a record and saying if you do have AAA, dump them as quick as possible.
Yeah, they
have screwed us.
For one, they were absolutely unprofessional. I've never called a place multiple times, and each person I got a hold of didn't want to be there.
Right.
You can tell. Can I help you?
Uh-huh.
It's like, okay, if you're not thankful that you have a job, whether it's answering phone calls or not, then go sit on your couch and let that job go to somebody who wants it.
Exactly.
Their professionalism is in the... toilet.
It's the worst. It's the worst out there. I mean, we've had other insurance companies, and well, we've only had really
Geico. We've had Progressive. I didn't quite care for Progressive and how they
handled us.
Geico
was pretty good, though.
Geico was pretty good, but they were more expensive to insure both our vehicles.
Right.
And we thought, oh, AAA.
Well, they came to us. They came to us like we can do it. All this. We're great at the roadside. We're the best at the roadside. We're the premier of auto insurance. We'll cut your rates down. We'll do all this.
There's discounts for club members and all this other stuff. And it's just a load of BS.
It's
garbage. They treated us like scum.
Yep. They didn't enforce. Here's the part that's upsetting. Is that they didn't enforce that the vehicle would be put on a lift and the engine opened up. Because there's only one way. Well, there's two ways that the incident happened was we had zero oil in our vehicle. Now, we had driven 40 miles that day, and we were driving back. As we're driving back, that's when the actual engine pretty much literally blew up on us.
And our car was away from us. We were nowhere in sight of the vehicle. The vehicle was around the corner of the movie theater when we went to watch. finding Dory. So, out here, people work on their cars in the strangest spots.
That is true.
So when you see some dude underneath the car, you don't give it two thoughts.
Nope.
So, yeah.
And unfortunately, where we were at, there was no cameras in the area, which might actually have been known fact to the person. The problem is that when you look at the situation, there's two ways that the engine would blow. Number one would be the engine would have seized up with oil, and it would have caused this incident to happen. Well, the fact is that we just had maintenance done on the vehicle 3 months prior. We were ready for an oil change, but one had been done exactly 4,000 miles previously. So the problem is that should have no conflict. We had no sputtering, we had no misfire of spark plugs, we had no black smoke coming out of the back of the vehicle, no leakage at all, anywhere. So there's really only two options. Again, the engine seized because of oil, or tampered. Well, the fact is that we had no oil light go on, so that's an indication right there. We didn't have any of the other signs of engine sludge.
It's just a simple fact that there's no reason for this to happen.
Right.
The police and the police mechanic has said that it is most likely being tampered with.
Yep.
So there's somebody out there that tried to sabotage us. This could have actually killed our family.
Yeah, we could have been hurt or killed from if the car would have exploded.
I mean, there's a little girl that just died in a car wreck on I-44 from a blown tire.
Right.
And so when an engine can blow up while driving, could have put my daughter at risk.
Could have put all of us at risk. And the problem I'm seeing here is that AAA, they went to the mechanic. The mechanic just said it was neglect by us. Now, the fact is that that's the biggest load of garbage out there, because 3 months ago, we had the car serviced, put parts into that vehicle that were needed, and we're, you know, throwing our hands in the air going, hey, wait a second. So, long story short, we actually were victimized, terribly victimized this past, you know, on Father's Day. And then, this week, we're told, it's our fault. Thank you, AAA. And if you want to know the name of the mechanic, if you're locally in this area, you want to know the name of the mechanic, just send me an email. I will tell you exactly who it is. And don't worry, from now on, you're going to hear nothing except for AAA is the worst company, and this mechanic is the worst mechanic, and it will be my campaign now from here on out. And of course, this is not the end of this story. We're going to keep pushing on this, and a lot more to come. But that's where it stands on that one, and I wanted to actually start off the show by letting you guys know that. So it is an outrage for us. We have been, you know, put in
that
spot.
We're the victims here.
Yeah.
And we don't know if they're going to tamper with our stuff again. I don't know if this was a mistaken identity. It wasn't us that they were trying to get.
Which
it was somebody
possible.
Else.
There is possible.
Because there are so many escapes out there that they all...
They look alike.
They look alike. And,
And we don't have markings on the vehicle. We don't have, you know, any kind of artwork on the vehicle. Let's say, you know, the vehicle, you know, is the podcast. We have the plates ready, but that wasn't there.
If something else happens to us,
there's a report.
AAA will be sued.
Yeah.
And sued heavily because they could have stopped this or they could have helped us and they didn't. They ignored it.
Well, look, they left us on the side of the road for 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
So they can go to hell. All right, well, let's move on to the Weekly Roundup.
The Weekly Roundup Seahawks.
All right, this week on our Weekly Roundup, well, I would actually say this week was the Great Pier Week. Would that be a good assumption? Last week was the Golden Doodle Week, or the Doodle Week.
Yeah.
This week is the Pier Week.
We had like four piers.
It seemed like every day we had a, you know, Great Pier. Not all were absolutely ginormous, and, you know, each one had different personalities.
But they were all sweet.
Yeah, they were all good.
That's one thing great. It's very rare to find a Great Pyrenees that is not sweet, that's not gentle.
They are the gentle giants.
Yeah, there are some that are extremely stubborn. Our one yesterday was extremely stubborn.
I was going to say, Friday's was stubborn.
It took 2 hours to groom that dog. 2 hours.
And that's not the bath only. The bath took roughly almost that as well, with the drying and the bathing, and of course had bad hips because it had been hit by a car. So But that dog could move when it wanted to. When it wanted to go somewhere, it was going to go.
Yeah.
It was funny. You know, one thing that we didn't have this week, which was a little odd, is we didn't have cats. We had cats last week. We didn't have cats this week. You know, I think a lot of it is the fact that we were prepared to have, you know, a three-day weekend, which is very rare for us. So, of course, getting through a five-day is kind of hard. So, I can pretty much say throughout the week, I was kind of going, okay, that's one less day. I'm going to get a little bit of extra time off next week, so it'll be nice. Anything really stand out for you?
No, I think it was pretty good. I think everything went rather well. We're booked until the end of August. That's starting to become a little overwhelming.
Well, trying to get everybody in is the overwhelming side.
Because we value all of our customers, and all of our customers, we want to try to do everything we can for them. And then it just gets to the point where there's just so many. I can't work miracles if I'm already broken and tired.
Right. Now, as for our updates on our fosters, let's see. All three, Lulu, Gemma, and Carl are going next week for their much-needed, overdue spay and neuter.
Yep. We're excited.
We are very excited to see that happen.
The kittens are fine just the way they are, but Lulu,
she
needs to get shots, she needs to get spayed, and she needs to get her butt outside again because you can tell she has lived all her life outside.
She seem like she has cabin fever.
Yes, she wants to get out. And, you know, we have a 3-bedroom house, so she has room to run, she has room to move. But when you're used to being outside all the time, and then you're only inside. Luckily, she hasn't darted out the door.
She doesn't actually want to leave, but you can tell she's got that cabin fever at the same time.
Right. And this is kind of odd for me. Her kittens are about 9 weeks old now.
That sounds about right.
And she still calls for them. If they're starting to get rambunctious and start jumping on things, she'll start calling them.
Yes.
And start yelling at him to calm down. I have never seen such a thing.
I haven't either. And here's the oddest part that I see to it is that Lulu is very... She's just not friendly when it comes to anybody else except for Callie. Callie and her became friends, and that's the only friend that she has. She didn't accept Spencer at all.
At first it looked promising, but then she was just like, nope.
Yep. That's the end of that. So, it was one of those odd situations. And now it's like, okay, you know, where are we at? And she's just, you know, she's now kind of having her little bit of a moment of her meow. She needs to be fixed. We knew that she was, you know, obviously she had to. Because it's such a distance to get to the vet, we actually had to wait until all three were ready. So they kind of pushed us. What would you say? We were pushed now 2 weeks.
Well, they were ready to go when our vehicle was ready.
But Carl.
Because Carl got sick and he needed antibiotics and vitamins. Now he's up to the proper weight. They were going to be taken to Bland, but now they're going to be taken here in town.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
Well, yeah. Nobody can get out there. The only people that can get all the way out to Bland or it's you and I with the escape. But since that didn't happen, going up to Raw Animal Hospital, and we're going to have to spend a little bit more for them to get done. But what's great is Dr. Yonke is really good about giving us discounts, giving Bacall discounts. So I believe he's given a 20% discount.
Huh.
And, ow. That was a...
What happened?
I went to go and get the water that fell into your phone so it didn't get into your little button, and I picked it up, and as I put my hand back this way, I flung that water in my eye.
Wow.
Ow.
I don't even know how anybody could do that, so congratulations on that.
Whatever. Anywho...
And Spencer's doing great. Spencer, though, unfortunately, Spencer has made his mark pretty
deep.
Yeah. I mean, he's going to be a difficult one to actually say goodbye to. Rambo, on the other hand...
Rambo's been... I think Rambo wants to be an outside cat.
I think so.
I think we need to entertain that idea.
Yeah.
He's not good sitting around the house. He's gained a lot of weight.
Yeah.
And he doesn't interact with the other cats. He's a loner.
Yeah, he's very much a loner.
He plays with the little kittens, and he'll play with Spencer. But he doesn't play with Callie. He doesn't play with... Mama Kitty. So he's a little bit of a loner. I feel terrible for him, but I think he wants to go outside and prowl.
Yeah, he seems like he's yearning to actually go and explore. And luckily he's fixed, so that's not a problem. So, you know, we're contemplating the idea.
We just gotta get him a little breakaway collar with our information on it so
right.
Nobody thinks that he ran away.
Right.
But to enjoy the outside a little bit. We got that creek bed right there. I mean, he might enjoy it.
Yeah.
I don't know.
He's got that person. I mean, look, he was born in the wild, in a sense. Not feral, but he was outside.
Yeah.
And he probably has that kind of, I want to be out there. And, you know, Mama Kitty, I think, well, Mama Kitty was a kitten, and we don't know how her situation really was, but she's actually kind of had that, I would like to go out there. But once she goes outside, it's like apocalypse happened, and she just freaks out.
Oh my gosh, she climbs up a tree and just sits
there. She does. Callie's never been the type. She was born in the house and never wanted to leave. She's gone out a couple times, but...
She wanted to go right back in.
Yeah.
So, and then the kittens, they love being with us. They don't mind staying inside. They haven't thought about going outside any. And then thanks to Claire, they... don't mind being held.
Right.
Gemma growls. But it's not one of those growls that she's going to attack.
It's a, oh, come on, let me go.
And stop giving me kisses.
Yeah.
Stop
snuggling. Not even a swat or a hiss or anything.
No teeth, no nothing. Just growl and protest.
Yeah, so it's going to be an interesting situation. We're definitely, you know, we're hoping for the best. We're hoping that they all get... on their way here very soon.
And we got to get Spencer into the vet room to get the deworming.
Yeah, Spencer's definitely got some kind of tummy issues that are
going on. I was doing a bunch of research, and it said if a kitten's belly has gone big, and not just chubby, but big.
Inflated.
Yeah, inflated, bulbous, it's typically a worm problem. So we gotta get him dewormed and see when I can get him spot on treatment.
Right. So we'll keep you up on all that. I mean, it's again, it's a lot of information going on, a lot of learning happening. It's just a great deal that's happening with fosters, and the unfortunate side that some of them are going to be making their way out into a forever home very soon. All right. Well, let's move on to GND News.
I don't watch the news because I'm a kid.
All right, this week on GND News, we're only going to have one story for you this week, which is very rare. I know we usually always have two, but this week we only wanted to do one because we also have an announcement to go with this this news article for this week. It's, of course, coming back from the Yulin Dog Festival. All of you guys probably are aware of it. It's become mainstream news as of lately, which I thought was strange that it's taken this long for people to kind of realize what's happened.
Well, see, it's what's annoying. Oh, wait a second. You still haven't played the clip.
I haven't played the clip yet. No.
Oh, okay. Well, then I'll wait. Sorry,
so,
I jumped the gun.
It's okay. So, with... you threw me completely off.
I'm sorry.
It's so hard. When you're doing a podcast, you have a microphone up here, or any kind of show like this, and you just derailed. You're like, where am I? I'm sorry.
I got lost.
I got lost. You know what? To heck with it. Claire, play the clip.
Every year, the Yulin Dog Meat Festival in China faces domestic and global criticism, with an estimated 10,000 dogs up for slaughter. Meanwhile, one man takes matters into his own hands. On June 21st, the first day of the festival, American activist Mark Ching announced that at least 1,000 dogs had been rescued. Since 2015, Ching has made 6 solo trips to Asia to document canine torture in slaughterhouses and rescue as many dogs as he can. The The tradition of eating dog meat dates back centuries. Ching says the common belief is that torturing dogs releases adrenaline, allegedly giving the meat special nutritional value. He said he's witnessed dogs burned alive and beaten to death. For his most recent rescue, Ching recruited activists around the world to join him. Ching told LA Weekly, quote, "There's this moment where you come into the slaughterhouse and the dogs are screaming, and when you rescue them, they know who you are." For Newsbeat Social, I'm Molly Real.
So, you know, it's a terrible, terrible, unforgivable festival that's happening that honestly was not supposed to happen. They actually had said, the government had said that this was never going to happen anymore, and it's still happening. I mean, they're never going to stop it. And there are great people who are going over there, and they're purchasing these dogs, and they're saving lives. Now, before we actually, you know, give our opinion on this, now, the reason why I wanted to actually use this is our only story is I've talked to the people who are actually representing Mark Ching and the organization that he works for, and he is actually scheduled to come on this podcast as soon as he's back from vacation. I can imagine he's much needed time away, probably, you know, for all that this man has seen, all that he has done, he definitely deserves the time. So as soon as we can lock down a day that works for him, he will be on the podcast. So I would say between the next, maybe next week, maybe a couple weeks from now, we'll have him on. And I'm really curious to hear from his perspective what it was like to actually be there. I know personally, if I ever had the opportunity to go, I would go in a heartbeat. I would drop everything that I'm doing right now, and I would go. Because what a remarkable opportunity to be able to save lives. But
I wouldn't be able to.
I would do it. I would do it. I would film it. I would put it on I would put it all together.
I will fundraise it. I will market it. I will get things ready for when they come back with the dogs, so the dogs have kennels and food. I would do dog food drives. I will do everything in the States here to get ready for them to come over. But there is just no way that I can handle that sight.
I would go so quickly.
Yeah, you would, but I couldn't.
This is kind of how we operate, though. I mean, I can go into these circumstances. I mean, I've been to a foreign, weird country before and gone over all kinds of weird stuff. So this would be nothing to me. Mm-hmm. I could do it. And I would love to. I mean, any opportunity, if that opportunity was come to me and they said, hey, look, we can't pay you, but we can get you over there. We can get you, you know, we'll cover your food and we'll cover your airfare and your hotel. That's all we can cover. I'd be like, tell me when, I'll be at the airport. I mean, I would do it for free. I put that out there right now. So, folks, if you ever hear an episode come up that says, I'm going to Yulin and I'm going to help, you trust me, I will be going there tap dancing. Now, of course, you know, our opinion on this situation has never changed. It's just unbelievable that there's parts of the world that still are so third world that they would actually do this. And to do it so barbarically, where the dog is alive.
That's my thing. I don't know where in the world they think that a dog being scared releases the endorphins into their meat that gives people superpowers. I'm sorry. That's not true.
They've been watching too many DC and Marvel movies.
Now, you look at, like, say, vegetarians. They look at it when we eat meat. And how can we do that? How can you do that?
Right.
You look at vegans. They think that we eat cheese and all this other stuff. How can we do that? How can we do that to animals? So, on one hand, it was like, well, they farm them for their meat. But then I'm looking at it as, no, they don't farm them. They catch them.
Yeah.
They take them out of people's homes. They steal the dogs. They keep them in horrific conditions. I mean, they're shoving dogs in cages where chickens, it's barely big enough for a chicken.
Right.
And
and they're defecating in their kennel right there.
On top of each other. Uh-huh. They're stacked up and they're doing that on top of each other. And they're just thrown into a pot of boiling water.
Or burnt alive.
And it's just, it's disgusting. If the animals in the U.S. were treated like that, there would be a huge investigation. Like, there are several slaughterhouses and such that do such things. They do not kill humanely. Slowly, but surely it's slowing down to getting to the point where it stops.
Luckily.
There are still places out there that are cruel to their animals before they kill them.
Right.
And that's the sickening part.
And we have a full episode. Last year we did one full episode. That's why we're not going to do it every year. We're not going to do a yearly episode about the same thing. Episode 82 was dedicated all to the Yulin Dog Festival. And we have a full-on episode that we talked about everything that went on there. And as I said, our opinion hasn't changed.
And may I mention and add to it too, when Obama went overseas, he also participated in eating of the dog.
Right. And we actually mentioned that in that episode too.
The dogs were not treated any differently. Obama didn't make sure that they were put to sleep properly and then cooked.
And he actually went off and said, this was great. I enjoyed it.
This was some of the best meat I've ever had.
Right.
So even our president doesn't have a problem with it.
Right. And that's a big problem. I just don't see how a world leader, especially of this country, can make that kind of comment and survived it, but whatever. It's not a political show, so I'm not going to give my political opinion, but it's unbelievable how it's still happening.
There's so many people that are, peace, love, and joy, and they will say, it's okay, man, that's their culture, man. No.
And we're from that state that would actually be exactly like that.
It's not right. There is a right, there is a wrong. There is no way you can tell me there is not, and there's a gray section here. No. When the dogs are going to the bathroom on top of each other because they're stacked 5 high, or they're shoved in kennels that are for poultry.
Deplorable.
Thrown in alive just to die that way.
It's terrible.
It's not right, and there is a wrong.
I'm looking forward to doing this interview with Mark. It's not going to be an easy one, I'm pretty sure. He's got some stories that they're probably horrific. And one thing that's going to make it nice about having him on is that, being a podcast, he doesn't have to hold back. There's really no ground that he cannot cover. He can say anything everywhere he wants to. And, with the hard part about doing these kind of junkets, when you do radio spots, TV spots, you got to worry about, your content has to be a little bit more PC. Podcasts, he can just completely go and say whatever and tell it exactly.
I'll make sure in the notes beforehand that there are some graphic.
Oh yeah, well, we said that when we did episode 82. We said it's going to be explicit content. It will probably end up being rated, under the rating of explicit, so you guys all know. And I'll completely post it out there. You guys will know when it's going to happen. I have to say their PR firm has been absolutely amazing. So I wanted to actually, put that out there. You guys will actually get to hear this absolute amazing human being on the podcast coming soon. I think that's pretty much it for you. Okay, well, that concludes GND News for this week.
Calling all pet rescue units.
All right, well, we actually have a bonus feature on this week's podcast. Luckily, this actually happened before we actually put all of the podcast in the studio. So it's going to sound a little bit different, of course. You don't have the crowd behind you. But we actually have a rescue story that just happened. And we figured, we need to put this into this week's podcast. So, Sarah, what happened?
About 35, maybe 40 minutes ago. I think about 30 minutes ago, really.
So about 8 o'clock or?
Well,
no, 7:40.
7:40 or so, 7:45. Okay. I see an email that came through. And since being part of a call, I'm checking my emails on all the time.
You're always on your phone.
Every time it goes off, I look. Well, there was an urgent call out to all the volunteers and the board members of a call saying that a mama cat just gave birth outside of the Ozark Actors Theater here in Rolla. Since my back's not doing very good and we just had a really rough week, we didn't go to Glenda's party, so we were pretty much available to head over. We jumped in the car.
Well, let me stop you right there. Dinner was just pretty much made. I had just
chicken and dumplings, homemade.
I had just kicked off my shoes.
Just
literally, like no kidding. I just kicked them off. I have a great movie that's on TV. I'm ready to go. And Sarah's like, "Hey, there's a mama cat that just gave kittens. We have a severe storm that
just gave birth to kittens.
Gave birth to kittens. And we have a severe storm on its way in. It's going to pour rain and
the cat's outside.
Somebody needs to go in and jump in to take over." Well,
it was pretty much, I look at you, you want to go rescue some kittens?
And it's like, of course I do. So, you know, fast forward, we get there, and, you know, what's great was they actually had the mama kitten put into a really nice box, Tupperware, one of those plastic nice boxes.
Yeah, what she did is the Tupperware.
That's the word.
Anyhow, she had a tote and she cut out a little hole in it and taped it up so the mom cat wouldn't scratch herself going in and out. Put a pillow and or some stuffing down.
Silky kind of material and a pillow.
Makes it a birthing box.
Yes.
Makes it perfect. The mom cats can still see out.
Yep.
And yet she still feels secure.
Right.
They were worried that with all the massive rain that's coming, that the kittens were getting sick and die.
Right. And that is a very good possibility that pneumonia would set in, especially with three...
it's extremely wet, and it's not warm out right
now.
No,
it's actually...
pretty chilly.
Yeah, for a July, it's actually really kind of cold. So, you know, here we go. It's like she was looking for help, immediate help, contacted a few... different nonprofits in the area. Luckily, we were available and we sprung into action. So, long story short, we've now picked up another three kittens that are about 3 days old, a mama cat, and we are continuing. I don't know where we're at anymore.
I don't know where we're going to go with this one. But right now, they said that they're going to raise money to make sure that all four of them get spayed and neutered, get vetted. And they're also paying for their food.
Right.
So that's something we don't see very often, people willing to pay for their food.
I don't think we've actually had this happen yet. I mean, this is quite amazing. I mean, to actually show up to a location where cats are literally already picked up for us and we're ready to go. I mean, that was amazing. But to actually be like, "Hey, we're here. We're going to do everything we can to help." I mean, that's just awesome. So,
and I don't think they were expecting us to get there that quickly.
Yeah, they did not think that somebody would be there. They looked at us like,
"Are you waiting for somebody?" We're here about a mom cat and kittens.
And they just looked at like, "What? You're already here?" It's like,
"Oh, you're here for me."
Well, this is actually Rescue 2, the temporary vehicle, and it's already flying and saving lives. So,
and Carl's trying to eat my food, so I think we should get going.
Yeah, I think it's time to go. So that's the rescue story. A quick update for all of you guys on this week's podcast.
With your host, Chris Green.
Hello, contestant, and welcome to Guess the Breed. I know we haven't had this in a while. Just decided, you know what, this week we needed to have it. It was just good fun, right? So how are you doing, contestant?
I'm all right.
I'm all right. Okay, well, this week I'm actually going to talk about the Prime Minister of Canada.
Because just recently it was Canada Day.
Yes, it was, actually. And this is, I don't know a lot about this guy, but I've heard absolute amazing things about Justin Trudeau. He's the new Prime Minister of Canada, been there maybe a year at most, something like that, I think. And he just recently adopted a puppy. This puppy was 11 months old, and he tweeted out a picture of it. Oh my gosh, it is a... adorable, adorable little puppy.
What kind is it?
Well, I will tell you. So, are you ready to play Guess the Breed?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Well, this puppy's lifespan... is it cute? Isn't it cute? Claire got to just look at the picture. Stop. This puppy, or this dog, is hypoallergenic. Okay? Scientific name, I'm not telling you. the lifespan is 12 to 15 years. Classification, dog.
Wow.
I love Wiki. They're so smart. Temperament is impatient, docile, obedient, quarrelsome, brave, and intelligent. The height on a female, 12 or 17 to 20 inches. Male is 20 to 22 inches. Let's see. This dog is a breed of working dog, as classified by the American Kennel Club. And the... I can't tell you where it origins from. I'm so... Gosh. That would just...
Weird. Dude,
I can't. I cannot tell you where it origins from.
That's not
fair. I know. Fine. Its origin is from Portugal.
Portuguese water dog?
That is correct. As I said, I give this away, it's over with. I'm like, well, Portugal, I mean, ding, 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 I mean, let me just give you the answer, right? Well, as always, it's always been fun. Thank you for playing Guess the Breed.
Ladies and gentlemen, put your paws together for a main topic.
And now on to the main topic. I am so glad, folks, that we don't do a live show because I could never, ever hold myself together. All right, this week on our main topic, we are going to be talking about the pros and cons on the top breeds. And now, are these actually top breeds in America or in the world? It looks like it's just, it doesn't really say.
It says 12 common breeds.
12 common breeds. All right, well, let's just
and
go.
And their health issues.
And their health issues. And of course, we see these kind of dogs all the time, so we have a real good indication on what these dogs are like as well. So, let's start off with number one, the Labrador Retriever.
And folks, the color of the lab does not have anything to do with the breed. Some people go, I say, okay, so you have a lab. No, I have a chocolate lab. So you have a lab. No, it's chocolate.
Is okay. It flavored chocolate?
And then, or, the, no, it's a yellow lab. Okay, it's a lab. Or, I know I got a black lab. I'm like, all lab lives matter, so what does it matter what color they are?
It's going to have a difference on actual, you know, the groom itself. If I have a chocolate lab, it needs to have a different groom than, you know, say a standard.
I can see wanting a brightening shampoo for a white lab or a black lab. I mean, but for the most part, they're all the same. The colors are just different, and they're all solid colors. So
America's top favorite dog is prized for its high intelligence. And again, I'm talking about the lab.
That can be questionable.
Well, we're talking about let's go with the fact that these dogs were bred correctly.
Okay.
AKC's, you know, papers. They were one thing, okay?
The AKC's are all up-to-date pedigrees.
Exactly. The intelligence and effectiveness, the affectionate nature in many ways. See, I get thrown off. That's really to stay focused, folks. My ADD has gone way off the grid here. Labs are perfect family dogs, loyal, gentle, and playful. Health issues with the energetic breed are relatively few. Provided the animal gets plenty of daily exercise, under-exercised pets are prone to weight gain and an increased risk of cardiovascular complications due to obesity. Now, let me stop here, folks. Again, what is the number one thing we talk about here? Nutrition.
Yep.
So if you're feeding this type of dog, if any dog for that matter, if you're feeding them garbage, well, you're going to have obesity, cardiovascular problems. You're going to have every other problem out there.
Yeah, if you feed garbage plus no exercise, you're going to have a recipe for a dog that should not weigh any more than 70 pounds to be weighing 100, 120.
Right.
Now, you can still have a dog weigh 100 pounds if you're feeding good food. Lab needs to go out and it needs to work. A good dog is a tired dog. A good, well-behaved dog is a tired dog.
Sounds like
dog.
A human.
Right?
Good, a good, productive human is a productive human.
It's a tired human.
Yes.
They're tired because they're being productive.
Exactly.
So you want to make sure that you get them on good food that gives them the proper steady amount of energy that they need throughout their day. And labs need to be worked. They need to get out there. They need to move. They need to run. They need to play. They need a job.
Yes.
And if they don't, they'll get bored.
Again, sounds like humans.
Yep.
Very much so. Inherited defects include eye disorders such as retinal detachment, central retina atrophy, juvenile cataracts, and
extra lashes. Yes, the extra lashes actually is very common in pretty much any breed. I know it's very common in Akitas, but what it does is that there's so many lashes growing in their eye or on their eyelids that they start growing into the eye.
Gotcha.
And it starts scratching the corneas. So what the veterinarian will do, it shouldn't be very costly, because even back when this surgery first came out, it was still under $1,000. So now it should only run you about $2,000 to $3,000. But what they do is that they'll put your dog under a sedative, knock them completely out. They cut like a triangle shape into their eyelid and then sew their eyelid back. And what that does, that takes out a good portion of the eyelid and pull it tighter to where there's not so much eyelashes.
Gotcha. Now the number two dog is my dog of choice. I love the German Shepherd. For some reason, that became my dog, my grooming dog of choice. And now when we say it like that, let me explain that really quickly. A grooming dog of choice is not your choice, it's the dog who chooses you, the breed that chooses you. That's mine, apparently. And so, for that reason, I'm in.
I see what you did there.
Another contender for America's favorite dog breed is the German Shepherd, and especially intelligent and easily trained. They excel at guard duty, but require plenty of stimulation and exercise to maintain optimal health. Chronic asthma is common among Shepherds, as it's, and I'm going to butcher this word, keratitis, are inflammatory condition that affects the cornea of the eye, possibly resulting in discomfort and or poor eyesight. German Shepherds are also prone to hereditary hip dysplasia and a deforming of the hip socket that may lead to arthritis or lameness. Ow.
Sorry. I was just looking at it. I'm like,
I look at it and I go, well, any kind of large dog of that size, hip displacement is common in a lot of different dogs like that. So, I mean, you got to worry about that with any, you have that problem with a lab. You're going to have that problem with an Akita. You're going to have that problem with a Great Pyrenees. You're going to have that problem with a lot of different dogs. Again, diet is going to be your big thing, and making sure that they're not jumping off of large, you know, areas. Like let's say you have a high deck, and they jump down. You know, if they land wrong, they could actually knock their hip out. What did you want to say on that?
It wasn't asthma.
It wasn't?
No.
Was that eczema?
Eczema.
Ah.
So, you're reading faster than...
My brain was going, okay.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for actually, you know, correcting me.
I didn't want to be rude or
anything. No, I was like, when you said it, you said asthma, and I go, oh, I probably meant to say eczema. I'm sorry. I stand corrected on that one. It's eczema. At least I got it right, though, after you said it. I don't think that was asthma. Okay.
But they can have very sensitive skin very quickly. Judy, who brings in all her show German Shepherds to us, has a special shampoo for him. It's an aloe-based shampoo, and it keeps him nice and hydrated while at the same time shining up the black in the coat and keeping him a nice bright color versus a dull color from just a regular shampoo.
And they're all so wonderful.
Did you know that now German Shepherds, there is now a breed-specific that is being added to all of their showing, is to where their back end cannot be too low to the ground.
No, I did not know that.
Yeah, you know, when you look at a German Shepherd, their back end further down than their head and their ears.
Right.
Well, they've been breeding the dogs to where the dog's back end is extremely low to the ground. And that has been causing a lot of health problems in general. So now they're changing the rules to making it to where they're only bent down so far. Any further than that is disqualification.
I find anything in that realm of discussion to be very strange. I mean, it's so intricate, and it's like the other day when she came by, when Judy came by, she was telling me about, you know, different things that were going on in that area, or even show dogs, and I sit there and I'll listen to her, and I'm just almost, you know, imagine me sitting there on the ground, my legs crossed, and I'm just kind of watching, and just paying attention. It's almost like a class for me. All right, the next dog is the Basset Hound. With their droopy ears and sad sack eyes, which I love that. It's so true.
That's a horrible way of describing
it. It is. These adorable dogs are plagued by problems related to their most endearing qualities. Droopy skin that might interfere with vision. Large, delicate ears that require regular inspections and cleaning. And penchant for constant enthusiastic sniffing. Yeah. Made all easier by their short legs, which renders these relatively unintelligent hounds prone to a variety of inhaled bacteria, parasitic and viral infections. Regular stool collections and analyzing may be required to identify potential infections. So because they're so low to the ground, they actually all the bacteria that are on the ground tend to rise to them?
Well, just like the Basset Hound, the Bloodhound as well, they have these huge ears that hang in front of their face. Now, these huge ears are meant to keep the scent in between.
Yes.
And keep it right in the middle of their nose. But, unfortunately, with the ears drooping down, that is a recipe for disaster for ear infections.
True.
Air hardly ever gets into their ear canal to dry it out enough to keep yeast infections away. But yes, with them being so low to the ground and all the wrinkly skin, an irritant can get in between that wrinkle and cause havoc.
Jeez.
When we wash Bassets, especially the ones that are more show quality, they have more wrinkles and more flabby skin. You really have to lift that skin up.
Yes.
And pull it apart so you can get into those creases. Along with, like, say, a bulldog, the creases in between our nose.
Right.
You have to get in there and make sure that stays clean, or a bunch of red nastiness starts building up, a stench starts building. Basset Hounds, you know, since they are short hair, but they do shed a lot, when they start shedding, you got to make sure you get the shed in between the rolls, because what happens is that hair falls out, but doesn't ever come out. It stays in that roll and gets together with dirt, grime, bacteria, and it
is... I was going to say parasitic, but yeah.
And just wreaks havoc. It can be very, very unpleasant.
And you know, you would think that, you know, back in the day when you would, you know, before we really knew all this stuff and these dogs were used, you know, for their fullest, you would think that, man, the health conditions must have just been deplorable. Mm. Must have been just awful, you know, go 50 years back, 60 years back, even a little bit longer. Wow. Alright, the next one. Now, loved one of these breeds. I haven't had a lot of Jack Russells that have been like the one that I'm thinking of. But only one Jack Russell I've actually come into contact with was like that one. The rest of them, not like that one. But these highly energetic, intelligent terriers are well known for their relatively good overall health and notable longevity. While some larger breeds may live in an average of 10 to 12 years, Jack Russells and closely related Parson Russell Terriers may live 14 to 16 years, provided they receive adequate regular exercise. Inherited diseases include glaucoma, which may result in gradual loss of vision.
I have not met very many Jack Russells that have gone blind. They might see shadows, but not fully blind. And the whole, you know, 14 to 16 years is extremely accurate. a Jack Russell is so high energy, you got to be careful. The Jack Russell that you're thinking of.
I can't remember his name. I never remember names. My mom's yelling at the player right now, and she's listening to this.
What is his
name? I can't remember his name. But
it was a Jack Russell, and he had a concrete backyard with a pool. So there was no grass for him to run. I mean, this was the middle of California. There's hardly any grass anywhere.
Well, usually your backyard in a California house is, 3 feet.
Yeah, it's just big enough for a pool or big enough for a yard, but not both.
Yeah.
So he ran around the pool all the time. Well, with the amount of energy he had, he constantly was grinding his nails down to where they bled.
Right.
So that means his quick was constantly showing. So you need to be careful with that. Making sure they play on grass and then walk on concrete, just make sure the nails stay down, would be pretty good. But make sure they're not always on concrete, so they're not always screwing up their pads and their nails. This particular Jack Russell that you're thinking of loved the laser pointer.
Yes.
And say you're not as energetic as a Jack Russell, which who is? You get a little
Claire.
Laser.
Claire is.
Yeah, true. Claire. That's it. That's the answer. Claire. Anywho, you can get a laser pointer and start playing with the laser pointer. We would run up the stairs and down the stairs.
He would go up all day. That's all he would,
And he never missed a beat. It wasn't like he fell.
Nope.
But it wore him out.
It took a few hours.
Yeah, but still he got wore out. So make sure with Jack Russells you keep him moving, because the worst thing in the world for a Jack Russell is to have stiff joints when it's 15 years old.
Next one is the Lhasa Apso. Experts describe these elegant dogs as robust. But the Lhasa... Yes.
Elegant.
I know. That's what it says.
Elegant.
I don't know. That's what it says. But the Lhasa requires regular eye care to maintain optimal health. Constant tearing is normal in this breed. The runny fluid... That just kind of almost deters exactly what I just said. But the runny fluid must be gently cleaned from the eyes on a routine basis with acetonic mild salt water solution.
Nope.
The Lhasa's long flowing coat requires extensive brushing and and combing to avoid snags and tangles. I think that would be called mats. This breed is also prone to potentially serious hernias. Exactly. I was gonna go with that one. I was like, I don't know what the other one was, but hernias and form of hereditary kidney disease.
Okay. Now, the whole mild salt water thing, I wouldn't do it. I would talk to your vet to find out what that is, because honestly, I've never heard of that myself. Nor have I ever had any of my Lhasa owners say anything such as this, or any veterinarians. But the way we handle it is a warm cloth, or a warm washcloth, a washcloth that has warm water on it.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And you gently wipe in between the eyes. Now, people like to keep their Lhasas short to the point where they almost look like there's... They look a lot like Shih Tzus. Differences, Lhasa's noses are a little bit longer. Make sure the groomer gets the hair out in between the eyes. Or let it grow to the point where it's heavy enough it hangs off the face. And then it stays out of the eyes. In order to do that, the dog's hair needs to be really long. Or the hair on top of the nose is long enough to put into a bow up top of its head. To keep it out of their eyes. It depends on preference. But it is very important to keep that area cleaned out and make sure those eye boogers don't get dried. When they start drying, then you start trying to get them off. You end up peeling back skin.
That sounds like fun. Alright, now that kind of gets us to the halfway point of what's, the top 14 dogs. So with that, we're going to bookmark it and make this a two-part episode so that we can cover the other half next week. That gives you guys an opportunity to kind of digest what we just gave out, kind of think about everything and not overwhelm you with all this content. Because honestly, it's a lot of content to go over, and sometimes that can be a little boring, right? What do you think? You guys think so? Yeah?
Yep.
All right. Well, Claire, you turned on the applause sign, so that must mean you want us to leave. You do? Okay, well, I'm Chris Green. Have a pet-tastic week.
And I'm Sarah Green. Make sure everybody realizes life is so short. Play with your pet.
Claire?
And play green, play with the kittens and pets.
And we want to wish everybody a safe and happy 4th of July. Bye-bye, everybody.
Okay, gotta go. It's my bedtime.
Shh, and now the show is over now.